will tell you, we had 25 lakhs people invested in the in those days. You know, always the maximum amount of fund flow comes at the peak of markets, when everything is looking good, everybody is happy in the market investing, you go on seeing higher NAV every day. So more people come, a lot of new money also come to the market at that peak kind of a situation, the cyclic. So people who invested just below, just before the big fall of 2008 January, if I remember, we had 25 lakhs clients invested, it went down to 16, 17 lakhs in a short period of time, few months. See, that doesn't mean they've lost money. That 16, 17 lakhs have grown back to 25 lakhs, 50 lakhs, 1 crore, 2 crores plus after that next few years' time. So this is the advantage of investing in small and mid caps. And traders, the leveraged investors, now they are the people who lose money. Those who try to gamble on the equity, which is a very serious investment avenue, unlike most people believe it. Especially Keralites, I always have felt, you know, mostly they feel decent people should not go near the equity. You keep your money in the FD or buy some land. That has been the traditional approach to investing our investable funds, the savings. Things are changing. So we had some very larger allocation of household savings to equities in the last 1 year, 1.5 years, for various reasons. Unfortunately, now at that, in the good spirit, the time of good spirit, you know, there has been a big fall, and but that money flow may not stop. That, it can slow down for the time being, but I'm telling you what we have seen, the domestic savings chasing equity, what you have seen is just tip of an iceberg. We are one of the best savers in the country, in the world. Of course, it has fallen from 30% to 33% to 30% of the GDP now. Even still, it's a very quite large amount of savings our households are doing. Indian households generally are not very leveraged. So in that context, the savings have got more relevance and importance, significance. So I am very, very bullish on small cap and mid cap at this point of time after the big fall. There is nothing to regret if you have been in the market, because we had a 5 years of unprecedented bull run, the way massive wealth was created by investors. In our own PMS, according to Varman Verma, the auditors for our system, Mr. Vivek is our auditor right now, and we had 45.2% CAGR, the 5 calendar years till this December. 45.2% CAGR is, those who understand the maths, it's amazing. Of course, in the first quarter of the current financial year, it has fallen significantly. But somebody invested 5 years ago is sitting on huge profits and huge return. Maybe somebody who invested 1 year ago, say 50 lakhs, it might have gone to 65, 70 lakhs and come back to that level and below. And somebody who invested fresh first time in December, November, December, January, there is a hit taken. If you go by the prices, I call it a paper loss. But whereas people feel it's a real loss, okay, my 50 lakhs became 40 lakhs, I lost money. I think this is not investing. Investors who understand what is equity investing will never complain that. This is just a paper loss if you are in the right stocks and, you know, if you are a prudent investor. It happens. Anybody get carried away when the markets are on an upswing, that also for many years, we develop some kind of complacency. So it's quite natural. Now, after this deep correction, I would say, there were multiple factors which was causing this kind of a deep correction when the Nifty and Sensex were staying very strong. And this is like something I would say unprecedented. We can't compare it with 2008 or the 2010, maybe to some extent. Again, something, a smaller version of this thing happened. So there were many factors. One was the euphoria earlier created. Most people were aware, including us, but we could not really act, because we are long-term value investors. We couldn't really act on that. But we don't feel bad. We never try to attempt to time the market. So that euphoria, the high valuations, even mediocre companies in the small and mid caps, they started quoting at 30, 40, 50 PEs. Expectation was very high. And a lot of people, knowledgeable people who have an idea about the economy, those who believed India need a change. India need to reduce the corruption levels. India need to work more of equality for every citizen. So those who were feeling that way were appreciating perhaps many of India's reforms, the life-changing reforms, the game, big game changes, starting with the demon. There is no point in analyzing whether it was successful or not. The GST, most importantly, the IBC, the NCLTs, kind of things happening. I'm telling you, this is unprecedented for the country. This can really change the structure of our country, the economy. Very, very powerful kind of things happening. At least an attempt by the government. It's an attempt. We can't say how much it is successful. It's too early also. These things may take time, 10, 15 years to stabilize and to be felt. See, India, what's our basic problem? We do not have income. It's like a lower middle class family, India's position, I'm telling you. You know, what's our total tax income? The revenue of India, 15 lakh crores. I call it peanuts. And what's our expenditure? These 15 lakhs, 80% of these 15 lakhs, our total income I'm talking about, it goes to 5.7 lakhs for interest payment. Something like 3.5 lakh crores goes to salaries and pension, and some 2.7 lakh crores going to the defense. These are fixed cost. So there is hardly anything left. Then we are borrowing money, then there is a budget deficit, although we are just managing. It's like a lower middle class family. We don't have income. And there is a huge potential for the country to raise this thing. So many of these measures which can, you know, which is, we are moving, you know, from evasion to compliance. This will take time, nothing can happen easily, you know. For various reasons, the way we managed our economy in the last many decades, things have come into a very bad shape in the economy. So it has become more and more challenging year after year. Perhaps we have lost the golden era of opportunity to grow like China. Now, we all know 30 years ago, India and China had almost same kind of an economy, the wealth. And where is China today? We are $1,800 per capita income. India and China had the same per capita income 30 years ago. And anybody can say, what is the China per capita income? Some wild guess? It's $8,500 is the per capita income. This per capita income is the key. Every person in the country, you know, on an average, have so much wealth or so much income. That drives the economy. That can drive the richness. That's the only way we can reduce poverty. So our politicians generally, you know, in the last many decades have mismanaged the economy is the only conclusion we can say. I'm not blaming any particular political party or leaders. Generally, the focus had been on corruption and, you know, their own wealth creation. So in which the nation's interest has taken a setback. That's the main reason, I always say, that's the reason, only reason we have 500 million Indians living in poverty. We all are worried about our returns, whether it can make 15% return or 30% return in small caps, where I have told earlier also, the mothers in most of these families, they are worried about how to feed their children this evening or tomorrow, or a visibility for the next week. That's the kind of situation we are facing. So anyway, the political worries, the second aspect which has taken this, you know, a lot of people started suspecting that the current style of government may not continue. I'm not talking about politicians or leaders kind of thing. And another biggest worry, I think among the knowledgeable people who understand India's economy and how politicians manage it, you know, the biggest worry is the recent development of a potential of a Khichdi government. That's what I think some people call. That's the most dangerous for the country. I don't know what, I'm not telling any, I'm not supporting all, but for knowledgeable people, that's India at this stage cannot afford it without any credible names in the leadership. If, you know, without any similarity, some 10 parties or a dozen parties get together and try to rule the country. And they very openly say it's not for the nation, it's for defeating one man. So that's the most dangerous situation our country is going through. I'm not again supporting or objecting to any political parties, but this is a political crisis. So the knowledgeable people in the market has realized, or in, you know, they are looking at this potential risk. I was just listening to Rakesh Jhunjhunwala yesterday. He was talking about Narendra Modi. Yes, what was that? The word he used. I just have written it here. I forget names facing an audience. So you know, he's a socialist, is what he was telling the Prime Minister today. You know, we have a small issue, which again, very knowledgeable people understand. Too much of democracy and a little of zero secularism is weakening our economy, economic structure, the social fabrics of the country. This is very, very important. Again, you know, I'm not going for any political discussion. What I'm trying to tell you, so there is some kind of gray area in politics where people wanted, a lot of people wanted this reforms. Now it's a painful thing. All these things are painful initially to implement because they are huge game changers for the economy and the country. Very painful to go through that for every citizen. But it's required. Now see the spaces, you know, when we come to the small and mid-cap, the biggest challenge, the risk factor, is the promoter's integrity and honesty. Anybody will agree. This is the biggest risk factor. I have gone through the pain many times, but still I am pursuing that. Still I believe India is getting transformed into a system with more transparency and room for more corporate governance. I think a lot of things are happening today, especially in the banking system now. With this IBC, the power is now with the lender. Earlier, the lender had no power. So here, you might have seen a lot of promoters are struggling. They are selling off the assets. First time, the huge fire sale happening among the large companies. They are selling off their assets. First time in the country. This has never happened. Because or they will lose their company. This fear of losing the company has never happened in the history of India. I really appreciate India for creating such kind of rules and laws and regulations enabling this. So there is real fire happening, and I think so it is, there is all clarity and visibility that India, our banking system is getting cleaned up, which was the fundamental basic problem in the last few years. Our traditional, the loan given in the last 10, 15, 20 years, the way it was managed by the regulator and the government and the politicians, and that created the huge mess today. So I think government is in the right direction in creating the rules and regulations for that. So that problem is really getting solved. Most of us are underestimating all these reforms. The impact of these reforms in our economy, in our growth of our economy, the growth of our corporate earnings in the coming 5 years and 10 years. I'm telling you, this is unprecedented. You have to wait and watch for the results. So there is something is initiated. Now, one need not really fully depend on the current government, even if another government getting formed. See, India has always grown despite all these politicians. Our natural growth, depending on the demography, I think that is always going to be there. So we need not really worry about the economic fundamentals, the macro aspects of Indian economy. We are going to grow. That organic growth is going to drive the return of equity investors. Of course, it's true. I had recently tweeted about, you know, if Narendra Modi and its the policies continue to be there for next 5 years, in the long run, our economy is going to grow 2% higher than what it would be otherwise. This is my strong belief. There may be a lot of people disagreeing to that. I don't want to make it a point. But this is my strong belief with whatever knowledge I have on the economy and how politicians manage the economy. So even without that, one need not be feeling, okay, it's a time not to touch, especially the smaller companies. You buy only the TCS, HDFCs of the world. See, after this fall in the mid-caps and small-caps, and this high-quality, large-cap companies staying strong, I strongly believe this is an opportune time to look at some of these mid-caps. The margin of safety is very high. and this is going to give you much higher return. I'll tell you some examples. Now, look at, say, Hindustan Liver, a stock, I think a lot of Keralites, I know a lot of Keralites comes to me, they have been holding in the last 10, 15 years, Hindustan Liver. We had many employees who were working in the Brook Bond. Some of those companies, Tata Oil Mill, they all had this stock. Some of them got it, ESOPs also, decades ago. And people have created huge wealth. Today, anybody know the growth rate of Hindustan Unilever? They are growing in single digit. Am I right, Aisha? 7-8% kind of. That is the growth rate. And we are giving a high discounting already. And they haven't made any huge wealth, if you see, in the last 5-10 years. ITCs, or even the Reliance, only this last 1 year it moved. So these large caps were stagnant for a long time, while the small caps and mid caps created massive wealth for the investors. So today, when we have a company, Hindustan Unilever, at 8% growth rate, and we are already giving it 30-35 price earning multiples. If you have another company, say one of my favorite company which I have been buying, I'm just telling you for example, I'm not recommending the stock, Kaya Limited. It's a little, not fully comparable, but a small company I'm talking about. This is having some 1,200 crores, that is the price of the company, which I expected to grow at 20-25% for next 5 years. And the estimate is that Hindustan Unilever may grow at 7-8% for the next 5-10 years. So the large companies with high valuation are going through the challenge of the growth rate. So similarly, if you take ITC, perhaps I can compare ITCs again, you know, that non-smoking business has been growing very big in the last many years, huge investments made. And even that non-smoking businesses, first time getting break even, started making cash flow, it's growing very big, but growing at 10%. With all these new things happening also, it is not expected to grow more than 10-12% for the next 5 years. So what kind of a PE we can give? The PE is directly related to the growth rate for next few years. Maybe a company called, we have been recently buying, ATFL, some of you might have heard this name, Agrotech Foods Limited. This is a subsidiary of Conagra, that US company, it's one of the largest food company in the world. So they are active in India. You might have seen that peanut butter and some of their Act 2, the popcorn kind of thing. They started in a small way. It's a very, very conservative company, clean balance sheet. So this company is now, after looks like an inflection point. This may grow at, say, 15-20%, maybe 25% for some years. So a company with 20% growth rate and available at 20 PE, or a company growing at 10% growth rate and available at 30 PE, so this is the choice. I have seen in my 28 years of career, these companies, the smaller companies, they emerge. And ultimately, all these companies were small caps. No company is born as large caps. If large caps are born, the mother will die. You know, it doesn't happen that way. HDFC was a small cap. HDFC Bank. Anybody is aware of the market cap, the value of HDFC Bank today? Yeah, over 5 lakh crores is the value of that company. It was just 500 crores, below 1,000 crores in our times. And most of that money was made by not Indians. That wealth creation from 500 crores to 5,000 crores, 80% of that money was made by the foreigners, because 80% is the foreign holding in HDFC Bank. It's not a local bank. It's not our bank. Indians were always told, you know, equity is risky. Put your money in HDFC Bank, never buy HDFC Bank shares. So now, anyway, better late than never, India, the Indian households have started investing in equities. Just started. Long way to go. I'm very confident about that technical aspect of equity. And India, we are at 2.3. Yesterday only a Prime Minister was talking about the need of growing at 2-digit. Which I have been talking for a long time. We need to grow because we have got a small base and we can do it. And that process, the structural change of from unorganized to organized, from black to white economy, from black to white, even in the households, not only in the economy, it transpires to the society, to the households, to the individual, all these aspects. So there will be more compliance, more taxpayers, it's already proven, and more this 15 lakh crores is, as I told, is nothing. We will have 20 lakh crores, 30 lakh crores, and 40 lakh crores income going forward. That is, most of that will come through more people participating in that process of giving taxes. So all, I think the stage is set for a takeoff of the economy by bringing development to the forefront. Now, if a new government come also, they are not going to reverse it. It's not going to be reverse. These are not reversible. These are very core reforms, values India's going to hold on, whichever political parties come to the power. So the stage is set for a higher growth. And when there is a higher growth happening, I'm telling you, the small and mid-caps, the smaller businesses are going to contribute significantly.
Well, that's very important, Vice Porinju, talking about,